whiskey. Tom Hayward, friend of the stream. The players. Tom Hayward's archetype is wrong, but other than that.
Tommy Hayward is on spicy Reanimator.
So we're seeing two graveyard decks. This deck has made a splash lately. This red-black Reanimator deck. Balls to the wall, turn one. I will make a fatty what-can-you-do-bro deck.
Similar to a Tin Fin style deck.
Yeah, it's like,
but less sort of degenerate mixed in with Storm and more, I'm just going to make something absolutely terrifying.
Yeah, this is a thing, what can you do? Whereas, Tin Fin's is very, I'm going to do all these things.
Well, unlike your traditional blue-black Reanimator that has, make this one very scary threat and back it up with counter magic and be able to sort of do that consistently with blue spells.
Yeah.
This version's very much a make permanent. Deal with it. Make permanent.
So this gets, you lose access to blue cantrips, but you get access to unmask. One thing I think is very relevant, you get access to the mulligan to six scry, which you don't get in blue decks because you have to keep seven. So there's that. And you know, you get to put a mod. Deep hand disruption package and occasionally stronghold gambit. We're seeing a turn one unmask from Tommy here. Card you see regularly in Dredge. Did David just play land and pass?
It looks like David did indeed play a land and pass. Unmask, removing a Thoughtseize.
Tommy questions the Corrigan. Now, what are your Thoughtseize?
I think I Thoughtseize the unmask the therapy because it gets one less use out of it. I think if I was David, I probably would have therapied myself there to get ourselves going.
Yeah, okay. Maybe if you don't know what your opponent's on, you want access to that, but I can appreciate where you're coming from. Tommy doesn't have the turn one.
Well, currently we have absolutely no way of starting ourselves off unless we draw a spell, so it feels like it's a worthwhile gambit to try and get ourselves into the game.
Tommy has notably discarded his second unmask, deciding that the cards are in David's hand can stay
They'll
in his
probably
hand.
Probably stay there for as long as we can keep them.
Oh dear.
David drew possibly the best card we could draw.
I mean, you know, he might not draw any dredges, but we know he has a stinky dip in hand, so let's see how this goes.
Unfortunately, he drew two of his Narcomoebas, which is
that sucks.
Not exactly
and
ideal.
And another breakthrough. So David is on the I'm going to dredge next turn plan, whereas Tommy is on the let's reanimate this Prison Band. So he has access to Dark Ritual and Tomb Exhume, so he can get any, and then reanimate, so he can get anything twice, basically. He's just going to Exhume, sorry. Is Exhume a May?
I believe it's each player May return.
Yeah, well, because that's exactly the... Yeah.
We're going to have Culligan fight Grizzlebrand. Tommy reading your Dragon Lord Culligan again.
So, I see a green splash here. Is that for Nature's Claim and Crystal Grip in the sideboard?
I would imagine so. Also, possibly a Abrupt Decay for Problem Permanent Side. Yeah. Rest in peace.
Yeah. Tommy now gets to pay seven, but maybe doesn't want to do that against the impending threat of, being attacked.
Well, if Tommy can find a Lotus Petal here, he can go again for another.
Yeah, he can reanimate. He's got a Dark Writ in hand, hasn't he? But yeah. He doesn't necessarily want to start casting spells when there's a Cogger in play. Tommy rereading Colgan for a third time. We'll get Colgan on the stream on the screen shortly, I'm sure, just to clarify what that card does, because it's clear that Tommy doesn't know, so I'm sure there's people at home don't know either. It is Dragon Lord Colgan, and he is a spicy one. We talked a bit about how Flamekins Ellis see a lot of play in Dredge. Dragonlord Colgan is a bigger body that does a similar sort of effect.
Big
gives all you guys
flying
haste.
Dragon that gives all you guys haste and also deals you some damage if you start casting spells with the same name as ones in your graveyard, I believe, is the effect. So Tommy finding some Chancellor of the Annexes here. Not particularly great at this point. One of those in our opening hand, ideally.
Yeah.
But we do see a Lotus Petal here and also reanimate. So we have found another way to get another creature into play.
Yeah.
Dragonlord Colgan, other creatures try to have haste, and also...
So Tommy can't really exhume very efficiently since he's just paid 7, so he's actually on 12. And with a reanimate in hand, it's looking like he's going lower.
So going for the Entomb here.
It was Entomb, and there's Reanimate. So he's going to Entomb and then Reanimate, but he gets a... He should probably... It would be polite of Tommy to play properly, since, I mean, it's unlikely he has a...
We're going to go for a Tide Spike Torrent here, which...
Probably Dark Ritual, Bouncy Colligan attack, which seems pretty strong. Oh, Tommy's a four. Feeling pretty safe, you know, Dredge and Army access to a lot of reach.
I think we just play this Lotus Spell here and bounce.
Wow, Lotus Spell, yeah, I didn't even notice he'd drawn Lotus Spell. And he's got access to Dark Ritual as well, so he can start bouncing.
He can also unmask away this Dragon Lord Colligan.
Seems good. Wait, seems okay, right?
See your Colligan, leave it in your hand, you discard your Colligan, reanimate your Colligan, put it in your hand, and then I'll get rid of it again.
Yes. Oh, he's bouncing land, yeah. And he... Guess have a look.
David not looking like he's having the best time here.
Being able to... I hadn't fully appreciated the ability to reanimate your opponent's Colligan. But Tommy doesn't appear to have a way to do that, however he can pay 7 and try and do it. I guess that's probably the play here. In fact, it was probably the play before attacking, since Tommy had access to the kill.
So he couldn't reanimate the Colligan because Tommy was on 4 after paying life with...
Yeah, so but if Tommy...
If he reanimates the Colligan, he just kills himself.
Splat. He doesn't have access to... Well, he has access to...
If he drives a line of play that we can imagine Tommy making.
Yep, that's fair. I mean, unfortunately for Tommy, you can't pay life you don't have. So he could have gone around the way, but... Yeah, I mean, I can see him reanimating his opponent's Colligan for the suicides. Wow, no Dredge. Yeah, this is... David's pretty far behind now. He must have a really sucky Dredge. What did we Dredge with the Sigweed Imp the first time round?
I believe there was a Prizes Amalgam. But nothing particularly great.
Oh, Tommy, not going for the... okay, yeah, GG's. So...
Moving on.
Do you board out all your reanimate targets if you are the Dredge player? It's a complicated one.
So you've seen an Exhume, which is obviously very good for you.
Yeah.
There's a lot of reanimation targets that you want to bring in, so I don't think you are, because you want to bring in your Archons, you want to bring in your Ashen, you want to bring in your Ashen Rider.
Yeah.
So I think, in terms of what we're bringing in, I can see Tommy bringing in his Tormod script, obviously, to remove graveyards.
As for everything else, I mean,
Pithing Needle, maybe, for Grizzlebrand. I imagine maybe Iona naming.
Yeah.
Maybe naming blue, but I'm not sure that's necessarily that great. And then from David, I think we're going to see.
Tommy doesn't know that he needs his Crossing Grip because David will board against Ley Line and a Fairy Macabre.
Yeah, and obviously the two targets that are probably slight upgrades on Dragonlord Colligan.
Mm. It's a complicated one because you're probably not grinding out a win against this turn one deck unless something's gone wrong. Like, as long as you're not losing on turn one and two.
Leyline of the Void's great here, obviously.
Yeah, obviously. And Tommy, I don't know if Tommy knows to bring in some sort of green spell to deal with that. It'll be interesting to see what he does. I would not have revealed to my opponent the fact that I have green in my deck by playing a Bayou in game one. But that's just me. Crackers as well from David, pretty strong. We saw it tides about time from Tommy, but and we know that he's playing Sire of Insanity, but he has those legendaries as well. I'm looking forward to see how this pans out, really. Dredge on the play again. We saw how powerful the Dredge Nut Draw was, and unfortunately just didn't get there this game. Sometimes the top six cards.
Unfortunately, the Dredge Nut Draws is a turn one hand, but it's not absolutely fantastic. It's very, very unreliable. Whilst this Reanimator deck is. It's three cards.
Yeah.
Well, four cards, including the land. But
well, no, it's almost. Yeah. It's almost three. Because
Dark Ritual into.
Yeah, as your Dark Ritual. Sure. That spells. Over two turns. Because the other thing is. Yeah. You've got that little bit more time with this Dredge deck than you had with like the Flame Super Aggro Frame Grinzella Street Wraith ones, where you just wanted to make four Icarids and attack them, and then make a bunch of zombies and attack them again. One thing we haven't talked about that the chat has talked about, thank you very much chat, is Ellis Norton in Tommy Hayward's main deck. There is one copy, which of course shuts off a lot of what David is trying to do when it comes to dredging.
Yes. Interestingly, no Cabal Therapies in this deck, so not removing any bridges that way.
No. Yeah, he's probably going to struggle to remove bridges. I mean, you can Tidespout Tyrant and then bounce the Animate Dead. No, because it exiles.
You can abrupt decay your own Animate Dead.
Animate Dead exiles the creature, right?
Does it?
It doesn't die.
Interesting.
Yeah, I mean, it's difficult. you can't even legend. You can legend rule your Grizzlebrand. That's like the out. If you really want to kill bridges, you can legend rule your own Grizzlebrand. I mean, that's going pretty deep. Probably a play that we have to keep in mind, but not one that you do every game.
That is certainly interesting. So kicking
off. One thing we should point out as well, Tom Hayward, friend of the stream. All round, well, I mean, there are words I can't use to describe Tommy, so won't. But he exists, and he would be crying if he was on the commentary booth and watching a player play a Blood Crypt in their deck. So we should take a moment to appreciate that, you know, Legacy is affordable. You can play Blood Crypt over a bad lands. I mean...
So Tommy looking at his hand here, it doesn't have any land or a Dark Ritual.
But he has a Chancellor of the Annex.
But he does have a Chancellor of the Annex.
Which I assume he revealed. I assume he forgot to reveal.
Which he forgot to reveal.
Uh-oh.
He might well just draw discard here.
Yeah, sure, I see, like, Petal Reanimate, so let's go.
Well, he can just draw this. He can just draw yeah. Tommy separating out his opponent's graveyard so that he can see it.
I think this is very reasonable. So we're dredging. Off to the races. Going? Spin the wheel. While we reveal. Well, so we see Leyland of the Void, so Tommy knows to play around that. I mean, he has bought in a Maelstrom Pulse. We've seen that's in his hand now. Fortunately, no lands. We saw more dredges there for David, and he has... Land go. Oh no, we can activate the Cephalid Colosseum if we really want to go mad. Since we're not casting the Safe Fluting anytime soon.
Doing that, we do risk missing off of our thing we didn't play. So it's sort of risky. Also, we have a Cabal Therapy here.
It's probably better to do. Now, do you name I think it's that name Reanimate here, and unfortunately, Tom has two copies. However, if he rips a land, we still have Exhume. I mean. He also gets to see his opponent's Chancellor of the Annex, they didn't reveal. I mean, I know Tommy's had a draw step, but come on, bro.
Because I think Dredge would actually be having an incredibly difficult time here if Tommy had revealed his Chancellor of the Annex.
Yeah.
He wouldn't be able to set players turn one. Well, discard spell.
Yeah, he would have slowed him down so much. It's time warp for Tommy that he's missed out on. Hopefully, he will not fit to do that again. But David, what do you name? I mean, obviously, we know to name Reanimate because there's two copies in his hand. It's probably the right name, but he's named
Lotus Petal.
That Thomas Crypto. Oh, jeez. Sorry. Was that an Elish Norn? It's an Elish Norn. Sorry, stream. I'm not a horrible person. How did he? Tommy, being pessimistic.
Thinks the second one's
right, so
coming
if,
off.
If Tommy rips a land.
He's got him.
No land.
Oh, awkward. Oh.
Well, now he has to play Crypt because he knows that his opponent will be just... Well, also he doesn't want to, you know. Is it right to upkeep Crypt here? Oh, because he's going to... Well he just insta-crypt?
It's very...
He's not going to insta-crypt?
Well, it's very awkward here because it means that David's now going to churn through a load of cards in his library.
Yeah.
And Tommy gets to then crypt away all of those cards and leave him with no dredges.
Okay. So he's going to play the long game.
Admittedly, David's going to get an Archemy, but... Well, the Archemy Retrieval will be on the stack. Because
the Cephalid
Colosseum has to finish triggering, finish its activation first.
Oh, no, David will have all the dredges in his hand, right?
So the dredge go into his hand, then he has to discard, and then once that's finished, the Narcomoeba triggers on the stack.
Yeah, he has to discard. Okay, so he has to... Yeah, Tommy is correctly using the stack. All the criticisms I have for him are null and void. HG Fox pointing out that Elishon is OP in this matchup and he did not discard it. Hey, HG Fox, listen here, you've not drawn 7 cards recently, have you, fella? Or whatever gender we should refer to back.
But
drawing 7 cards.
It doesn't even matter if drawing 7 cards is better, because as we all know, the most fun thing you can do in Magic is draw more cards. It's why when you kill your opponent with Stroke of Genius, it's the nicest thing you can possibly do.
Hey, it's so polite. Yeah, pretty interesting stuff. So, if Tommy had resolved the Selection Order, are we saying that it's, he's a firm favourite? Is that the actual real way we work things? We're putting this Chris Ryan into play. David has no graveyard.
So, do you just have to bait your opponent into using the crypts as soon as possible with the... Did David play correctly? I've not played a lot of Dredge.
I think I probably would have tried to continue. The issue is you... It's a double-edged sword because you kind of want to go slowly and just hope that Tommy doesn't draw the lands so you don't get blown out by the crypts.
Mm.
Equally... You want to go quickly because if Tommy draws the land, you're going to die.
Yeah.
So, because the chances of Tommy whiffing here when he has zero pressure is pretty low.
God, I'm doing Tomb of Doom. I'll draw seven. My go? Draw a card?
Because ideally what you want to do is get to a point where you can get a Cabal Therapy into your yard and use it.
Yeah, for Tom Davis
to get those reanimates out of his hand before Tommy draws the land.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Tommy has drawn land at a very speedy pace.
Inevitable moment. He is drawing seven again. I think that's ballsy because you have access to Entomb Reanimate, whereas now you're limiting your opportunities. I appreciate that Tommy has double Dark Ritual in hand and probably going for the Exhume, but David has no cards in his graveyard. But you know, it's pretty spicy here if. You know, so in the response to the Exhume, you activate LED, discard like Blazing Archon.
Tommy's drawn the Iona here, so we might see an Iona naming blue, which will lock out David of most of his outs.
So I think, yeah, Tide Spout Tyrant is another good target here, just to continue that theme of prisoning your opponent to death. Three black in the pool. Casting a Thoughtseize. On himself. Respect. Oh, because he's drawn the Tide Spout Tyrant and can't attune for it. And then with the leftover two mana, put it into play. Now cast. Petal.
So you assume David's going to choose not to respond just by cracking his LED to
creatures. Like that was you know, there was a moment there that Tommy could have been further behind than, well, not just one. Unfortunately, David didn't get there. Does Tommy know the vast majority of David's hand, just due to breakthrough things?
So he'll know most of it, yeah, from the dredges.
Yeah. I'm not sure how many dredges David chose to discard. So we don't know how much of his hand is known, but Tommy pointing out that he can basically storm off at instant speed. Whatever you do. What's it now for some? Oh, he's got to discard down, so he's... Yeah. Does he have a lethal next turn? Not quite. He's one off. And there's a handshake, yeah. Rough matchup for Dredge, that. I suppose, like, fast combo decks, just, you've not got that turn one pressure. I assume David boarded in the Mindbreak traps, but didn't get there. And sometimes you just don't even need three spells, right? So, quick 2-0 for Tom Hayward on the bottom tables. Yeah. So we saw the Maelstrom pulls out of Tommy's sideboard, correctly brought in against the Leyline of the Void from David. I think that's like a pop. I think Tommy can make a better game call and assume that the Dredge player is playing Leyline.
It's a reasonable catch rule as well for any kind of problem permanent your opponent might play.
So you get to randomly Maelstrom pulse to your opponent's Dragon Lord Colligan. With it being a one-off, it's the most appropriate answer to it. Yeah. What do you think of this black-red reanimator deck? I know that Stuart Saxon and Tua Jackson, if you're watching, having a lot of success with it, or some success with it, from what I understand. It's seeing a lot of play elsewhere around in Europe and the US. Sire of Insanity and Jinga Taxis are very good cards to put into play on turn one.
Tommy going through his board here, brought out the Unmask and the Sire.
Obviously, Sire letting your opponent discard their hand when Dredge is the matchup is not exactly what we're looking for.
Yeah, it's a pretty bad one. If you want to play game one as well.
I got you.
Get ya! Okay, I'll discard my Dredges. My go? Thank you. They were just talking about his sideboarding.
Yeah, he's brought in a Caracas for the...
So we'll do our best to bring you a second match shortly. What we can talk about is the top four, as I've received word they've ID'd. So we do have the two players we saw in the last round. That's Henry Kay and Ben Flanders, finishing in a draw. That was Alluren versus Enchantress, Nick Fit thing. And then we also have Lee Brook, who we saw playing Miracles in round three, and the person we've not seen on camera, which is Lewis Marchbank, playing Infect. We talked a little bit about how Infect might storm this top four, but if it comes up against Miracles in round one, you know, there's the possibility that that doesn't happen, although I'm going to assume that...
So it's we have a lot of explosive decks in the top eight. It's very interesting because Reanimator has... This Reanimator deck doesn't have...
It's
necessarily
top four, isn't it? So we're not seeing... The Reanimator player is unlikely to make top four.
Is there a Reanimator player is not... Sorry.
It's going to be...
Lost.
So Infect, Miracles... Alluren and Enchantress Nykthet.
Sure. So, Infect's the aggressive deck.
Yeah, the only really aggressive deck.
And then the rest of the decks are sort of very controlling. Or
Super control, then Miracles control, and then Shardless.
We have Alluren, which is sort of mid-range with a combo kill, yeah. So very Splinter Twin-esque.
Yeah.
So it'll be interesting to see how that pans out. There's some unusual matchups for,
yeah.
For
we definitely
brackets.
Get to... as commentators, navigate some exciting board states for you guys at home. We can talk a little about the overall meta today. You know, we've seen some real rogue decks, you know, Dredge, spiking tournaments every now and then. This black-red reanimated deck looks like a lot of fun. Dan Partridge, who we might not have seen on camera, playing Jund, as well as Stuart Emerson's four-colour brew-esque pyromancer thing. Pretty varied meta, pretty exciting meta. Some impressive tech coming out today in IQ Games Huddersfield here at this Northern League event. It's been quite a lot of fun to watch, I'm sure you can agree. We're just chatting about the matchup.
Tom here with their new haircut. Let's chat about that. How are people on stream feeling? Not sure myself.
Tommy still probably recoiling. It's probably his hair has fallen out from winning two tournaments in a row.
Oh my goodness.
Welcome back to the booth. Still Luke, still Barney. Rocking at IQ Games Huddersfield for this Northern League event. We're going into the top four now. We've just received our matchups.
The bracket.
There'll be some discussion as to whether or not we're going to stagger semi so that we get lots of the camera time. And we'll get to that later. But the first matchup that we'll definitely see on camera is...
It's Henry versus Lewis.
Top seed Henry on Nick Fit versus Lewis on Infect. So, Infect, we've talked about Infect as the aggressor. Like, boom.
Definitely the most aggressive deck in the top four.
Shout out to Alfie at our local store, who is playing, who's regularly turn twoing people, even though it's like quite difficult to do on that deck, going like turn one Glistener Elf, and then somehow managing to get enough cards in your graveyard to become a Menzies Glistener Elf. Like going like Trip Invigorate, Invigorate, get you. And it's like, that, you know, in fact, definitely, don't expect any turn twos on camera, guys. It's like a 0.1% chance of actually turn two.
It's slightly higher than that. The Berserks really help you out. You can,
yeah.
Berserk plus Invigorate means
double Invigorate Berserk, yes.
Just Invigorate Berserk kills with any creature.
Sure.
So you can make a turn. You can make a turn one Glistener Elf, or you can make a turn one Inkmoth Nexus, which is slightly less good.
Not at all. Yeah, he struggled to cast your Berserk. Yeah. It's like exciting. You get some exciting opportunities there. But I think that's, you know, fairly niche. I don't expect to see any turn twos necessarily.
It's not something we're gonna likely see a lot of. I know that Lewis's version is playing slightly more Gataxian Probes than most lists.
Okay.
Sort of check for the kill early and go for a bit more.
Gaseous Probe, that's a card, isn't it? I've seen it used in a lot of decks today, even the decks that, you know, well, it does a lot of effect making 1-1 Pyromancer tokens for Stuart Emerson.
It's one of those really interesting cards that, on a base power level, you look at it and go, yeah, this is all right. And then you think about it, and it's like, that's actually just really good, isn't it? It's just, just like the best utility spell.
Sometimes, you know, like, when you sit down and you evaluate your life, even as a person outside of Magic, you think, you know, is two life points worth drawing a card? You have those decisions regularly, and usually the answer is, yeah. Unless you're on two, the answer is probably yeah. So, that card OP, you know, even seeing played non-blue decks, you know, we've seen it in Dredge.
Yeah, it gives you information, it gives you card velocity.
Yeah, with Cabal Therapy, it's an excellent combo, and we're probably going to see Cabal Therapy from Henry as his main way of interacting with Lewis' Infect Kill. So the other side of that almost two-card combo is seen on Henry's side of the field. Cabal Therapy, when you know what your opponent is on, gets much more powerful. Mm. Yeah, we saw the Dredge player in the last round choose not to cast the turn one Cabal Therapy because he wasn't 100% sure on what his opponent was on, and just discarding a card for no real value isn't necessarily very strong. We'll look forward to seeing what Henry names, because I'm going to assume he's going to be mulliganing towards, particularly in game one hands, with that turn one Cabal Therapy. Probably naming Glistener Elf, assuming he knows what his opponent's on. Maybe naming cards like Invigorate, where if they have multiple copies of that card, it's OP, or cards like Daze if you want to resolve spells. It's a complicated one.
It depends what Henry's looking to do. I think Henry is not actually going to struggle to deal with the creatures that Infect has. I think it's actually going to struggle to deal with the spells.
I'll look forward to seeing what sort of Abrupt Decay removal package Henry has. Deadweight doing work, because unlike Disfigure, you can't just invigorate and keep your guy alive.
I feel that Lewis may get his his Glistener off deadweighted and feel like he's playing Scars of Mirrodin in a Strid standard again.
He can block and through to that was an interaction, wasn't it? No, it wasn't quite.
Ask his opponent if he's playing Sun Titan to bring that back. Why isn't this Nick Fitbit playing Sun Titan?
Why isn't he playing Sun Titan? Get Henry down here and interview him about why he's not playing Sun Titan.
First question, when he wins.
So Henry, why are you not playing Sun Titan? I like the interactions there with that deck. I mean, it would be a fifth Starfield, assuming he's playing four. I'm assuming he's not playing four Starfields.
Starfield.
yeah, sure. I'm excited to see. We're going to go to the feature match area now.